welcome to the New York Society for Ethical Culture. My name is Anne Clayson. I'm one of the leaders here in this ethical community that was established in 1876. We believe that everyone has worth and dignity. And you come to a place where you meet one another on a common ground of ethics. So we've been fortunate enough to be meeting as a community since 1876, and in this particular building since 1910. This is our meeting house. And I know many of you have been here before, and I hope that you will return. We're so fortunate to have this gift from that first generation so that we are able to have a home for this ongoing community of ethics. And we're able to invite people to our home who share our values. And so you're in for quite a treat tonight. I believe that, if I look around, I'm sure many of you know the gentleman who will be conversing tonight already, and I want to encourage you to also check out their books that will be, that are in the lobby. So I'm hefting them right now. So this is from Jeffrey Sachs, The Age of Sustainable Development, and Altruism, and this is by Matthieu, Ricard. And so make sure that you take home a souvenir of this night's conversation, and then we'll have book signings afterwards. So it is with great pleasure that I introduce to you our speakers tonight, and they will be having a very relaxed conversation between two friends, and aren't we fortunate to be part of that conversation with them. So,
I really wanted, as a culminating point of a lifetime of living with great masters, meeting wonderful thinkers all over the world, with Jeffrey Shannon almost 2 years ago, and people from all walks of life, environmentalists, psychologists, social workers, working in the humanitarian field. I've always wanted to make a case that yes, of course selfishness exists, I don't need to write a book to prove selfishness, but that there's definitely genuine altruism is part of human nature. It's not all of it, but it's part. It's the potential is there. That was my initial goal, to show from different perspective. And then there's not enough to show that we can cultivate it, like any of the fundamental human qualities or skills that we have the potential for, but unless we actualize them to the optimal point, they remain dormant. But while embarking in that process, I discovered that so many things were related to this dichotomy between altruism and selfishness. I have no whatsoever to have a chapter on the environment. So of course, I'm passionate about the environment, what does it do with my subject? And then I realized, just to give that example, however complex it is politically, economically, and scientifically, it is the end. It is a matter of selfishness versus altruism. Because if you don't care for future generations, there's no environment problem. So then it was like a field laborer flowing one row, two rows, and looking at the field that got bigger and bigger and bigger, and I could not see the end of it. But I wanted that everything that seems to be where this dichotomy between altruism and selfishness play a major role, address that, including the contrary forces. Because suppose I made a good case that altruism exists, and people say, eh, look at the genocide, psychopaths, what do you make of that? So I had to see how does that work, what are the mechanisms that leads to mass massacre? What are psychopaths, what is their characteristic, what can you do about it? The lack of empathy, how does it come? From burnout, to different. So this again grew bigger and bigger, and then I had an interesting case for altruism, after all the opposite forces, and then what? Black and white, what do you do? No solutions. So I have to think what we could propose in the field of education, economy, governance, sustainable harmony. So that's why it took 5 years of intense work and research. And in addition to that, just to finish, since I came as a Buddhist monk coming out of hermitage from the Himalaya, I thought if I said this and that, I said, what is he talking about, this guy? So I had to substantiate everything with solid research, otherwise, there's no way anyone would have taken that seriously.
You're one of the few Buddhist monks coming from the Himalayas with a PhD in molecular biology. That is, of course, one of the remarkable, one of the many remarkable things about you, too, that you have seen the Western scientific perspective and treasured it. In the most rigorous way, Nobel lab of Jacques Monod, molecular biology, with a PhD dissertation on cell division. You've seen a completely different society and civilization and heritage that is a 2,500-year heritage. Maybe I could ask you, because in the West, you have to write 600 pages to say that altruism is a real thing. Because the starting point is, for some reason, a lot of skeptics think, oh, that's not really altruism, that's hidden selfishness. And a lot of the book is showing truly ingenious experiments, by the way, to say it's really altruism. There's no hidden motive there, it's really caring about someone else. But in the West, we start from the presumption that there must be something in it for that altruist, you know. What would your teachers say if you told them that you had spent 5 years to prove that altruism is real? What would their reaction be? And why would their reaction be that?
They might have said, that I'm just trying to write something. Depends which teacher you're talking about.
Your teacher.
But I have several teachers. My first teacher were really from the contemplative tradition, transmitting these 2,500 years old wisdom and compassion teachings, encouraging their students to actualize that in their own life. And they were also warning the students that unless we have really matured something within, it is very hard to really meaningfully help others in a wise way. And also we don't have the inner capacity, but it means like a beggar who wants to give a better way to have a beggar, not just to, or like a deaf person who wants to teach the piano or something like that. So the idea also that you should not get the wheat when it's still green. So when the wheat has matured, as a crop, as a harvest, and we can distribute the way, so we need to develop that. I think if I look at one of my most important teachers, which is the Dalai Lama, he's very much encouraging us on the cooperation, the research, the science, and he's very much in the promotion of secular ethics that can we do. I remember very well the first time in 2000, when I participated in the first Mind and Life meeting, which brings together great scientists and others. And then it was on destructive emotions. And it was from Ekman, which is Denison, was a major of those
great neuroscientists.
And then halfway through the week, the Lama said in the morning, it's all fine in discussion. What can we contribute to society? And then we have the idea to propose this kind of collaborative research. And so he's been very much encouraging me to continue that. So, in a way, encouraging me in my personal life to balance some kind of contemplative retreat, that's about 3 months a year, and the rest trying to share peace. So I call it 3 months in peace, 9 months in pieces.
I want to talk a little bit about the starting point of...
There's just one way. That's very clear. And I went back to the retreat and I'm going to one of the night and I said, well, I'm going to resume my retreat, so what should I practice? And he said, in the beginning, practice compassion. In the middle, practice compassion. And then practice compassion. So that was the issue.
Maybe at the opposite end of the spectrum is a writer that you discuss, Ayn Rand. How many of you have read one of Ayn Rand's novels? We have a problem.
If you do that in France, it's about what it's about. It's a really interesting phenomenon.
It is, of course, an amazing phenomenon for me. We have several presidential candidates that call themselves disciples of Ayn Rand currently. We had a famously governor of the central bank who was a disciple of Ayn Rand, who blew up the economy in 2008. Not completely unrelated, by the way. But one night I was reading Atlas Shrugged, rereading it for something I was writing in economics, and there is the famous 100-page speech at the end of John Galt. And I read it into about 4 in the morning, and I realized I was at the end literally soaking wet with fury and anger, because this is portrayed as the great defense, but it's the speech where he says, if you as much give a smile to a beggar, you're committing a crime, because you're encouraging this kind of behavior of irresponsibility. So this is obviously perverse extreme. You explain that she was a very unhappy woman, which is another test of philosophy, I suppose, which is if your philosophy doesn't lead to human happiness, there may be some question about it. But you've seen this vast panorama Well, she chokes me up every time. How could we arrive at a point where Ayn Rand is considered a philosopher for a significant part of our population? So we take as an example, that's the extreme.
Of all places, because I have to complete my work, I have to sequentially to read Ayn Rand in when I was 12,000 feet high in Tibet. I would not imagine reading Ayn Rand in Tibet somehow. But I didn't read my homework, and especially I listened to some live interview with Donald. She was saying really revealing things. For instance, that he asked her, what do you do if you see someone drowning? He said, well, if the suffering that is dead will, that caused me the suffering is dead, will be stronger than the risk I take, even if it's a little risk, then I should say it was not. So I thought, well, you know, I'm so sorry to say this, but I said that it's not the problem of one person who is really unhappy. No. But it's the question is why this idea became so appealing, and that's kind of could be a mystery, but I think it's too difficult to think about that. Now, human nature, of course scientists don't like to speak about human nature, because everything that happens in our mind or in nature is natural. So you get so hate is part of human nature. And of course, altruism is part of human nature. So you can say human nature, at least from a scientist, which is what you do, is fundamentally good, that is human nature. However, there's two other ways you can examine this issue. One is more like a contemplative way, and just come back to it. But also, say, take a particular species, like human beings, you could ask, do we have, from early childhood, bias towards kindness, towards social behavior, towards cooperation, or towards relentless, you know, selfishness and survival of the fittest. And I think, precisely contrary to Ayn Rand, Freud, who wrote literally, for whatever I know about human nature, most of them are rascals. So that's more like a judgment. Ayn Rand is more like advice, or it should be like that. But this is really not what last 30 years of research has told us. Many research, but with young children, even with babies, have thought exactly the opposite. There is a bias towards collaboration. I mean, all the work of Thomas Edward Barnick and many others have shown that, you know, if you take infants that are barely crawling on their fall, and an experimenter drops something, they can't get it. They will leave a pool of beautiful toys they are completely involved in. They will rush 2-3 times to pick up that 95%. And then the work of Paul Bloom and Pierre and his team, they showed me many small infants, they stare at puppets. Some are very nice to the other puppet. They had to open the box to get something. Another one comes and slams the box. And then there's of course the blue puppet, right? And then you give the blue puppets, and you see the baby looking, you simply don't know, but 95% tend to be the answer to a good puppet. But they did with 3-month-old babies. Of course, 3-month-old babies don't jump puppets, but you follow their gaze, and 90% of them stare at the puppet. Not towards them, but towards someone else. This other experiment by Paul Bloom, for instance, the two kids and give them sweets and keep on doing that. And at some point you they feel it. And about to give the sweet to the kids and you say, should I give to that one or to you? Some say, give to the other one. And you feel that. And those who say give to the other one, they beam and smile. The other ones, one is empty, one is a nice piece of chocolate.
selfish, doesn't feel so good. Of course, people don't feel good at what it happened. So there's some kind of tendency in most in that direction.
One of the.
It was also reproduced with chimpanzees.
Yeah.
It showed that it goes like 5 million years to a common ancestor, and it's not something that we can magically use.
There's also a wonderful video, if you haven't seen it, of the monkeys that are showing a slightly different thing, but the concept of fairness.
Oh, yes.
I don't know if you've seen that, but it's worth looking at the YouTube where two monkeys are next to each other, and if they're both given a vegetable, they eat it. They prefer being given a sweet, and if they're both given a sweet, they each take it. But if one is given a vegetable and one is given a sweet, then the one that is given the vegetable throws it away, pounds the table, and demands what the other one got. And so there is this sense of fairness also. And what about me?
Well, there's another wonderful experiment with chimpanzees. Is you give them the tokens. There's two chimpanzees in two cages. You give them the tokens as a red token and a green token. And then when one chimps, a green token. No, sorry, you give the tokens, a lot of green and black. So when he gives back a green token, he only he gets food, and the other one doesn't get. When he gives a red token, both get food. So in any case, he's getting food. After two or three tries, he looks at the other one and only gives red tokens.
To make sure both get.
Yes. And although it's no benefit for
pure monkey altruism. And did it evolve out of us, or what happened?
So he didn't have that by itself.
One of the things that I came to discover about my own field, my own profession in economics, which is a very strange field actually, with lots of evident perversities, which I could describe, but a tendency to believe in the most selfish, that selfishness is the economic person, indeed. And one of the odd parts of economic training that we are trained in is the idea that people have their tastes, we call them utility functions, and that that the purpose of the individual is to maximize utility, of course, and that's what we do as consumers, or trying to maximize our wealth. But the interesting thing for me is that in economics, we're trained to believe that those tastes are given. That's just the individual. Nothing to do about it, not even to question it. If the person is selfish, if the person is greedy, if the person likes blue, if the person likes green, that's the tastes. Tastes are not to be disputed. And utility is something that's just given. What you describe repeatedly throughout the book is a very fundamental idea of cultivating compassion or cultivating altruism. And it seems to me that one of the most fundamental, perhaps the Buddha's most fundamental message, is mind training is essential for human well-being. In economics, it's the opposite. Don't train your mind, maximize whatever's in it. In other words, go for your, however it comes about, you have a set of preferences, maximize them. But the idea of cultivating your better spirits is, I would say, a fundamental part of the Buddhist outlook. There's a lot of modern evidence about neuroplasticity and about how idea about how practice does make perfect in that sense. And even in Western thought, I find myself often feeling to be an Aristotelian because I really admire Aristotle's ethics about virtue and the need to practice a moderate path, which is also a middle way, which I see and feel has a lot of resonance. But it's also about habit, cultivation, and mentorship. It's not that you're born with it one way or another, but that you have to develop this organ of compassion. it's there. It's latent, perhaps, or maybe not even so latent, but it can be perfected. It can be developed. And maybe you, if you could describe it, some part of that, also from the Buddhist philosophical point of view, what does it mean to cultivate the best side of one's propensities to compassion or altruism? What is the training? What do you learn? And how can you make that choice actually?
So this, I'm sometimes mystified by the fact that we know that most of the skills and the capacities and the knowledge and know-how we have, it came to a lot of cultivation. I mean, none of us is obviously born knowing how to read and write and much more complex things of which we spent 15 years in school, professional training, learning musical instrument, great chess, or any other skill, juggling or name it. But when it comes to fundamental human qualities, for some weird reason, maybe because the mind is still not how to deal with it, a bit scared to look inside of what we define as it escapes or doesn't know how to handle that, we sort of see that this is like an exception. That somehow either is engraved in stone, whatever we are, that mixture of light and shadows. Take it or leave it, you know, myself, I have to know my defects as much as my quality, the color of my life, etc. Unique personality. But that's kind of a counterintuitive, or it's not very logical to think that this set of fundamental qualities first will be immutable, or that they will be at the top, right from the beginning, without doing anything about it. That would be even more unlikely. So I think it's like any other skill, like you know, not to run a marathon, you train for a few years, most of us, possibly, probably not me at this stage, but could run a marathon. Although I have a friend who's 65, he's a teacher at the University of Montreal. He started running 2 years ago, and again, he's running a marathon now after many years of running. So now, when it comes to those qualities, we know what it is to do physical fitness, you know, we rush on this bicycle that goes nowhere, it's not fast. The person from Nepal, India, you see those people, sometimes you see those jeans from the street, you know, like, they would be totally amazed, crazy.
That's development.
They lift those weights just like that. Someone there. So, now it's part of compassion, you know, better physical health and mental health. But we're still sort of a little bit hesitating about this notion that when it comes to focused attention, loving kindness, compassion, emotional balance, inner freedom, we would not need to become more familiar with how to cultivate those qualities. That's quite amazing. And in fact, you know, of course, we have moments of unconditional love for some child, for someone who is great for us. But it comes and goes, something happens, we get up, someone comes into the room, we think of something else. And we are not in the habit of our culture yet, it's coming more and more thanks to many good teachers. But that we will do that for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, we have time, and we are the habit of doing it. Practice, by the way. And so if you do so repeatedly day after day, even 20 minutes a day, you will change. Your brain will change functionally, structurally. Your immune system will change. Every training, no elasticity, is simply the change that occurs in the brain when exposed to experience, novel activities. It could be to become a starter, but it could be also to become a compassionate person. So now, of course, those who have done that in their life, they know the effect it has on themselves. They can see the effect it has on others. You can call forward that by exchanging with the teacher who guides you, who avoids that you fall into pitfalls or deviation. But thanks to now the great part of the situation in the Milan. This collaboration started 27 years ago or so with my institute, and many labs are coming doing serious research on that, and now it's very clear all those research have shown that yes, the brain does change. And not only if you have done like 50,000 hours of meditation, which is too much asking most of us, I guess, but 20 minutes a day for 3 months or even 1 month, as I said, in 2 weeks, you can already in 2 weeks see the change of this compassion meditation in the area of the brain or the amygdala that has to do with the fight. So he showed that the voice of reason, that is the traditional way of promoting self-interest, rational way, cannot do two major things which are two major challenges of our time. It cannot address the question of poverty in the midst of plenty. You know, maximize the personal interest by raising the wage of Bangladeshi workers. It cannot address the common goods, quality of life, or the ocean, or the environment, or democracy. Step out of that. So he clearly said we need the voice of care, not the voice of reason. I think the word care is widely chosen. If you then, and that was the only form of measure of this, you have to be compassionate. Say, okay, fine, I can be my life, it's simply not find my job. Today, we can't say,
could be the case that any individual has an incentive to pretend to cooperate, but then to break from the cooperation, to cheat on the others, and get an even bigger gain. And the outcome of that, if each person is thinking individually, quote, rationally, would be that everybody ends up cheating, the cooperation fails, and everybody suffers as a result. So this is a famous idea that I'm sure many of you have studied, called the prisoner's dilemma, strategic interactions. Now, when you actually put people experimentally into a situation where they're given an opportunity to cooperate, but they have an incentive to cheat or free ride, in the normal population, you find a mix of behaviors. Some people take the opportunity to cheat, others cooperate. The economist's technical prediction is that everybody should cheat. That's rational. That's, and Ayn Rand would say that's the only moral approach. Otherwise, you're leaving something on the table which you shouldn't leave in your negotiations. Now, here's the interesting thing from my point of view, and very I'll tell two aspects of this. First, if you compare economic students playing this game from students in any other field, the other fields cooperate a lot. But the economic students cheat on each other and end up worse off. Systematic. And then there's been a long debate now for 25 years, is this true? trained in capacity, or is it the weird people that go into the field, self-selection? Sadly, it's a little bit of both, it turns out. But there's definitely something wrong in the training, because you're told, of course, chief, that's the rational thing to do, quote unquote. And it trains to actually take away the cooperation. Don't think about it in a global way. Think about your interests and defend your interests individually. And if your counterpart is a sucker enough, so be it.
Well, you see, you said that at least, in fact, experiments, both elsewhere and not in love, show there's actually a clear majority of people who are ready to go.
Absolutely.
Is that the way to go?
Yes. So, except the economics rules.
So the free market hijacked the system. So what we need is to create a climate where trust can prevail. And where those which are the majority who really cooperate and that ensure again and again can do so safely without a free rider hijacking the system to the extent that they rule it again. So you have to control this complexity and they start in many ways as they
It's exactly that tendency to cooperate is there. If cooperators cooperate with each other, they make quite a nice arrangement. But it can be invaded by those who are ready to take advantage of those who would otherwise cooperate. So I wanted to refer to another very interesting study that just came out at the beginning of this year. Fascinating for us living in New York, I think, because we're at the center of the world financial industry. These researchers took a major bank and got an agreement with the bank that they would do a psychology experiment among the bankers. And they took 1,500 people randomly that were employed in this major bank, which was not named in the article, unfortunately. We might guess some of the candidates. And they allocated the researchers to two different categories, a kind of control group and the treatment group, so-called. So in the control group, both groups were given the following test. Flip a coin 10 times and report how many heads you got on the coin. And they were told, the more heads you get, you're in a kind of competition, so the more heads you may win a prize. Okay. So the two groups were both doing the, and no observation of the flip, so you had to self-report your result. There was nobody observing whether you were telling the truth or not. You just flipped and wrote it down and submitted. So two groups. One group, the control group, was given a list of questions. How old are you? What city were you born in? What was your mother's maiden name? Those kinds of questions. Just normal, regular questions. The other group, the treatment group, so-called, was given questions about their role in the bank. Which division are you in? Was it a profitable center last year? Questions that put them in the mindset of a banker. Now, these were randomized banking populations, so no difference of the people in the two groups, because they were randomized into the two groups, but they were primed differently. One, normal, the other, primed to remember you're a banker. So the two groups then flipped the coin, and the group that was given the normal questions reported 50% heads. Actually, it was 55% heads, not statistically different from 50%. The banking group, that was no different from anything except that it filled out some questions which branch of the bank were you in, reported 59% heads, which was statistically impossible. Basically, four standard deviations away from an honest coin. So they didn't know who cheated, but they knew as a group, that group cheated. So it turned out, to become a cheater, all you had to do was to be reminded you're a banker. That's a problem. This same randomized group was asked on the exit, is money important for your social standing? Now again, randomized, one group said no. The group that was just reminded that their banker said 70% yes. So how simple it is
to get in a mindset.
So we call that reverse mind training. So,
isn't it something?
Yes, but as you know, what people say is context preferences are context independent, that shows that it's not true. So that's why also somehow to provide not only when we raise children, education, social life, a strong component of benevolence, of cooperation, more cooperative system of education and competitive. Within cooperation, we insist on really unconditionally cooperating with sharing information, working as a team, possibly getting a team reward instead of individuals pushing themselves to appear to be the smartest and the brightest. All kinds of ways of approaching which will foster trust, and if people trust each other, they easily cooperate. And if they cooperate, and if they feel to be the best in themselves, on top of that, if you have cooperation, or even in the studies, to have some activity that are cross-social, that have the DNA of higher education, or cooperation. And then somehow, people feel more motivated to do.
Not at the top.
and not changing even as income rose 3 times in per person on average during the last half century. And that has come to be considered the big paradox. Why is the happiness stuck? But what has happened is the trust in the US has gone down very measurably. Simply that question asked over 50 years, can you trust others? It has fallen sharply in our society. And we went from a relatively trusting society to a very low score on this measure over the past 30, 40 years.
You know, there's a nice story about different in Denmark and New York. You know, in Denmark, when people go to restaurants, like mothers, many mothers, they live there with a baby in the crowd outside the restaurant so that they can get fresh air. And nobody worries about that. They didn't all do that. So one Danish mother came here. She just came very recently. And then the police came and arrested her for abandoning her child. Something like that. So now the link that you pointed between happiness and sort of benevolence. If you look at, for instance, a similar study was done by the OECD about 10 factors that contribute most to well-being. So income was about 50 or 60. Number one was quality of relationship. That means in the family, in the workplace, in society. That was by far what people reported to be the strongest determinant of their quality of life. So what means, what does it mean, quality of human relationship? It's not based on selfishness. It's that if you can always be selfish, what kind of quality do you have? And I think what you said about the relation between altruism and selfishness, I think can be summarized in this very simple idea that the pursuit of selfish happiness is just going to fail. It's a bad bet. And there are two categories of reasons for that. One is experiential. So if you just take me or them, you are in the bubble of self-centeredness. First is very stuffy. That it's going to be an easier task extent that one of the founders of positive psychology, Frederick, is called the supreme emotion of love, love for the others. So you feel very good, but of course, loving kindness is not just, it's not basically fundamentally about you, it's about others oriented. So then you would have to see that relationship with others and others, of course, you see it as a person that is good to live with. And then it works, because now it is attuned to the recognizing the true nature of interdependence, because I don't want to be here to suffer. But I'm a deluded, confused, but still I'm right. I don't want to, I don't wake up in the morning and mess around the whole day. So even I don't know where to find my next, I really like to be able to suffer. So it doesn't take much not rocket science to think, oh, if I go in that person's mind, she doesn't want to suffer. She also might be delivered as I am. So in a way, this common sentience or common humanity that so much related, all of happiness and suffering comes through and with that of others. So once we recognize that, this is really a fertile ground for compassion, for kindness, and whatever else would harm. And it's going to work, because now it's attuned to real nature of so it's a twofold benefit.
It's a
selfishness is a lose-lose situation, and what is a win-lose situation. And if you are an economist,
that's bad.
After a it's too good. The economy of altruism is like that. Number one, as Albert Schweitzer said, love is the only thing that doubles everything every time you give it. Very good return on investment. Second one is a paper published in Sachs. He says, money doesn't buy happiness unless given to others. We're studying 27 countries, people who give us, people who don't give, even $5 a month, and they're very well controlled for social status, health, age, education, and people who give are significantly happier than those who don't, so now you know where to go.
Absolutely. Let us open it up for their microphones on both sides.
Oh. Okay. Hi. Okay. Jeff, you just said first I want to thank our guests for having the most relaxed conversation. Okay. Jeff, you just said what we'd like to do is have a 20-minute or so question and answer period. There's microphones on either side of the stage here. So if you want to get in line, you can do that. But before we start, I just want to say one thing. Anybody who would like to buy books at, what we'd like you to do is form a line out here by this door, by where Paul is raising his hand, and we're going to have to line the screen out there. Jeffrey and Matthieu are going to sit outside and they'll do book signing by the lobby. But we want the line to be here and not out of the lobby, but we need to keep the doors open for people to be able to leave who want to leave. Okay? So anybody who'd like, 1 second.
Thank you.
Yes, so before I go run away, I just want to say that one of my reasons to be also here with all of you and with Jeffrey, and what keeps me coming down to my habitat where I've been fine looking at the Himalayas peacefully, is that we are really trying to do compassion in action, you know, pure heart and dirty hands. So just to tell you that our organization, Kabunda Seche, I wanted to call it compassion in action, in France they said no way, it's too religious. So Kabunda means compassion, and so we now normally help up to 20,000 patients a year in India, Nepal, and Tibet, and 25,000 kids are in school every week. And especially in the last 3 months, because of the two major earthquakes, 400 plus aftershocks in Nepal, with wonderful solidarity from all over the world, including here from the United States, from citizens, we were able to help 200,000 people in 570 villages. With food security, 600 tons of rice, shelter, 15,000 tents, medical aid, and now for the next 2-3 years, we're going to do community rebuilding, with food security, solar electricity, reconstructing religious schools, preventing human trafficking, integrated program in 12 of the 15 districts. So before we go, in case I forget, I wanted to share that this is
how do they find it? How do they contribute?
Very easy, you can contact your leaflets outside. Anyway, it's not rocket science.
Does it have something to sign?
Yeah. Okay. Is it made in outside? Otherwise, it's Kadula, KAWNA.HN.com. And our story is very easy. It takes 3 clicks. No big
deal. Okay, we'll leave it to the question. Let Jeffrey moderate the questions. And you just ask if you have questions, please.
Please just introduce yourself briefly and then a question.
My name is Ricard. I live in New York. Bonsoir, Matthieu. I wanted to ask you if you can help us, because as you just illustrated, in the eastern part of the world, there's a lot of material poverty for the organization and many others are helping. But here we have a lot of spiritual poverty. And I was wondering if you had a 1 to 3 minute spiritual exercise you can lead us in to help us develop more compassion for ourselves and others. If you could do that for us, I'd really appreciate it.
She's asking for the spiritual poverty here. Is there something you can recommend to help build compassion, our own compassion, like the meditation or other device to suggest?
But I think one which is really wonderful, which I learned at Google, or the evaluation basis. I have a good friend there from Maine, and he's the jolliest man of Google on this visiting card. So he came once, we were meeting with the Dalai Lama and serious people like Richard Davidson and Madison, and he made a speech and said that a big secret is the 10-second meditation. This guy is really not serious. But we know that everybody is speaking, and we ask 20 minutes, we say, hey, come with these 10 seconds, what can we do? But then I thought it's quite smart, smarter than it looks. And I remember the teaching is better to have short, repeated period of practice than a very long one from time to time. So what is the 10 second meditation of loving kindness? Every hour, when I will spare you the night hours, let's say 7 times a day, 10 seconds, you have 10 seconds, no? Right? Anyone can have 10 seconds. What do you do? You don't jump on people's leg and I get you in trouble with the service. But you look around, through the window, in the street, you go to your co-worker, if nobody is there, you think of many people. And you wish, from your heart, for 10 seconds, fully, any condition,
thank you. such a the problem of evil, which is so prevalent throughout the world, and examples being such slavery and rape and abuse of people by people, I'm not thinking of hurricanes and tornadoes, it's a natural phenomenon, but people destroying people.
How does Buddhism understand the existence of evil
and
explain it?
How does Buddhism explain it?
Yes. Depends on which level you take this question, of course. Psychology, going contemplative. For Buddhism, you would say that the ultimate evil, call it Mara, demon, is fundamental ignorance. That may not seem very threatening, it doesn't come to me like that. Why? Fundamental ignorance is not just not knowing the telephone directory by heart. It's a distortion of reality. It's the reification of a solid individual self, and then others. And then, oh, you see something is 100% desirable, 100% unpleasant or hateable, solidified. That leads to attraction, aggression, hatred, craving, obsession, envy, arrogance. That destroys your happiness and that of others. So in one way, very strong grasping, solidification of reality is what you would probably call it. Even in the sense that it is the root source of so many kinds of suffering. There's not a single war that didn't begin thought of hatred in someone's mind, and then spread to a few other people, and then to the masses, and so forth. So if you can get rid of that, then you can get rid of it. Now, in the psychological level, I read a very interesting study when I was researching the book by Roy Baumeister. It's called Enemy. And it shows, is there any really people in the world just come out of the blue and whose only motive is to harm. So most of horror movies are like that. I mean, I don't look very much on horror movie, but I'm fascinated by why people would look at that. But anyway, some people would look at that. And typically what happens, you have a happy situation with your happy family, and something comes, a personage, it could be a monster, it could be a psychopath, comes out of the blue, not understand why, his only mission in life seems to be half for the sake of half. And that's what creates this immense fear, because you don't see how to handle that, because there seems to be no other purpose in that person's action from A to Z to half, and that's it. Well, it turns out that it's never the case in real life. Even the worst offenders, the worst dictators, the worst perpetrators, for completely deluded, mad motives, reasons. Those reasons evolved for some multiple causes and conditions that make them believe killing others might be virtuous, all kinds of causes and conditions, but somehow they all have a notion that they are doing something that in their highly deluded eyes makes sense. So in that way, it shows delusion brings that. It's not just pure wishing to harm for the sake of harm. So in a way, it's almost tragic that those things happen. But it is reassuring because at least we can deal with the causes. When I did, I came in June from this book, one very often question that was given is, what do you do about ISIS if you are closing with your mediation? It's unfair to ask someone who's trying to deal with the root cause to say, okay, the forest is in fire, what do you do now? This didn't come out of nowhere. For years and years and years, there are reasons why 4 years old kids who didn't dream of behaving people somehow in their horrific situation in the best possible way to minimize suffering and save those who are victims of that. But also to keep on addressing in medicine, we all know that prevention is better than trying to cure a pandemic. So I think altruism is really extremely attentive to the cause, the emerging causes of suffering, just like we do prevention medicine. So in that sense, preventing that something become what looks like death is to try to find the sparks of animosity, of malevolence, of selfishness, of indifference, of cruelty, before the forest is in fire.
I think it's extraordinarily important what you're saying, and important for us in practice, in foreign policy, in other ways, the idea that evil is some form of ignorance or some inability to understand the situation, or what we may perceive as quote pure evil is that we don't understand the other and we haven't taken the time to understand. And in this country, in the last five wars, we've been told the adversary is pure evil, irrational, pure evil, and can only be destroyed. And of course what this does is cut off any other avenue for consultation, diplomacy, cooperation, anything that could find some understanding of why there is this root challenge. And so I think that approach, I just want to underscore it, is extraordinarily important, because our tendency to also ascribe quote pure evil to others is, as you say, a kind of ignorance that if we worked harder on our own knowledge, we'd find a much better approach.
And there's this funny example, you know, neuroscientists and my friend Greg is here, keep on telling you that gray matter in our brain is like 30 years old, but certainly not in the memory area. So, in any case, a few years, 2-3 years ago, there was this incredible massacre in Norway, right?
Yes.
I forgot the name of the preacher. He's really the closest portrait of evil that we can think of, this young guy that goes and killed everyone. I was very struck by when the person in charge of interrogating him and really conducting the inquiry, I was interviewed. And he said, the way we proceed is we don't just bang on the table and say, you know, you must tell us what we can do. We need to understand. However, incredibly, and it seems impossible to understand, but we need to understand what happened so that this young man became what he was. Otherwise, how can we ever hope doing anything in society so that this has been produced?
Not sure it's working, but speak up.
So this discussion has touched a lot on economics and compassion, economic maybe versus compassion. We also briefly touched on banks. And so I wanted to ask about the relatively recent growth of interest in sustainable finance, and kind of what do you attribute that to? Is it just banks kind of, you know, trying to create new opportunities, maximize their profits? So the rational side, or do you think that maybe compassion has penetrated even that field? And I guess in that sense, I'm also asking if you think that there's a general, that there are genuine opportunities there to create a more compassionate, to create a more sustainable economy.
Yeah, just say a couple of words about this. One thing you may have noticed is that the Wall Street banks almost every week pay a new fine for something. And it's gone on now to about $100 billion of fines over the last 6 years. The culture really is broken. And it's not a casual observation, it's not a factual, evidence-based observation. And the study that I mentioned from Science Magazine is a very ingenious kind of evidence about that. But we see it in the outcomes that something really deeply went wrong. And the greed did permeate the environment. We saw it a couple of days ago when a leading hedge fund manager excoriated CEOs that had gone to the White House to sign a declaration of President Obama on climate change. And this hedge fund manager attacked them for violating their shareholder interests by signing on to this climate change control. So this is a very serious issue. It's not solved, and it is not, I think, a light issue. I think it's a very serious issue, in fact. When Lloyd Blankfein, the CEO of Goldman Sachs, said in 2009, after being fined for $700 million fine for having sold knowingly junk to foreign investors who lost $1 billion on the transaction, he said, well, they're big boys, they should look after themselves. In other words, it's okay to cheat them. That's our business model. And then famously he said soon after that, we're doing God's work. So very peculiar and not good. So you ask the question of, first, is there a different way? The answer is there had better be, because this is not just greed and something as crude as a Michael Douglas movie. Not that the movie's crude, his character is crude, or Deco, I mean. But actually something very debilitating for our society. It's costly in the trillions of dollars, this kind of bad behavior. So there has to be a better way, because we can't actually, we're not thriving this way. We're digging ourselves deeper into mutual loss. Sustainable banking is the idea that we should be ethical in how we make investments. And there is a movement that is quite a growing movement. It's still a fraction of invested assets, but it has commanded some pretty powerful investors recently, including the Sovereign Wealth Fund of Norway, which is one of the largest funds in the whole world, nearly a $1 trillion fund. And the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, which came from oil wealth, divested of oil because of the climate change risk this past year. Really a wonderful statement and a wonderfully ethical principle. And one thing that Matthieu does in this book is he talks about the social context. It's not the only way to get the moral behavior. There's the inner way, and there's the reflective way, and the meditative way, and the cultivation. But there's also the fact that society creates a context. And if we go along with this kind of bad behavior and don't call it out, we also all lose. So we have a certain responsibility of demanding ethical behavior all the time, whether it's from our politicians or from our bankers and so on. And I think we should speak out, and then we're attacked on how naive you are. Grow up! Don't you know how the world works? But the world doesn't have to work that way, and it's not functioning that way properly. So the long and the short of it is, there's a little bit of that happening, it's growing, and it's absolutely worth cultivating.
Great.
Good evening. Thank you for coming tonight. I read both of your books, and Mr. Ricard, I've given away many copies of many of your books, so I appreciate what you're doing with this book. But it creates a problem for me, because no one I give this to is likely to read that book, given how big and impressive, like to my niece, my nephew, my mother, and so on. Do you have plans to make that book in a form that is like other books, like Happiness or the Meditation books, that is really something that everyone will read? Thank you.
So he's one of you.
10 seconds, 7 times a day. Yes, that's the question.
Okay.
Also, maybe for young people too.
Yes, yes, of course. Well, I thought is that sitting low about the post-traumatic altruism syndrome or something like that. Altruism post-traumatic syndrome after 5 years of birth. But I think there is a, you know, if I didn't do put all these things together, I'd look carefully around. You know, I thought there would be, I would never have written if it was existing. I'm no special, I didn't invent anything. This was important to put that in one place. It's imperfect. I could have worked another 10 years and made another paper, could have had to make it better. But the fact that it exists as a basis to, if you want to promote altruism, you look at the evolution of culture, you look at education, I try to bring together all the factors. So it's just there, at least. So now, of course, you know, how do you, so, and then if there wasn't all these 1600 references, I have to do that work. Now, yes, there should be something like you know, pragmatic altruism in practice. You know, how do you really do that? And how do you share that with younger people? I don't know if I have we happen to do that, you know, sort of time runs, life goes by. But certainly there's a need, I think, for a very simple, hard message. And well, that's a really wonderful way. Well. But you know, it would be great to have a testimony to that. It's true that we need to see what are the really, really most important factors to put that in actions in our lives. You know, one thing would be the banality of goodness. You know, we are so much obsessed with bad news, terrible things happening, but we forget. Most of the time, most of 7 million beings behave in decent, benevolent way with each other. That's the fabric of life. And why we're so struck by the exception, the horrendous, is because it's the trend, it's abnormal, it makes the news. We've seen 40,000 violent deaths when we're 20 years old on TV and movie in North America and Europe. That's the new reality. So there will be something about that, there should be something about increased trust. I mean, there's many subjects that would make a much more concise way to go into practice. There's also something that Peter Singer just did in his book, The Most Good You Can Do, about effective altruism, not just based on sentiment or when you cry, when you see a photograph, but when you do it, and when the best choice to use your limited time, resources, and energy, and thinking, relieve suffering as much as possible. So I think there's so many wonderful people on the meditation side, on the neuroscience side, in the economy, trying to bring together a better world. And I think really most people would like to have a better world. Certainly altruism is the most common denominator that could give us a common platform to do that. Selfishness would not do the job. Especially to reconcile the three time scales of the need of the economy, short term, the care for economies and the service of society, in the midterm for social justice, inequalities, flourishing in life, thriving, that comes through trust, healthy social relation, human relation, other relations. 1.3 million species are co-citizens in this world, they're not just there to entertain us as instruments, they are alive on their own, their interests and value, not just commercial. So we need to revise it. And then, altruism is the only way to deal with the future generation. So that at least we have a common concept from economies to social workers to environmentalism to together work for a better world. And it's the only one that works, by the way, to reconcile those two time scales.
And what a beautiful, if I may say, with our new sustainable development goals, economic, social, and environmental. Matthieu has just explained, there they are, hold up the SDGs, yes. Everybody has to know them, all 17 of them, please. But the idea is that those are the timescales. That was an absolutely magnificent summary from the short, medium, and long term, which our nations have just adopted, thankfully. We have to make them real, because they're not real if we don't now pursue them, live them, achieve them. But they do exactly embrace those three dimensions of economic, social fairness, social justice, and environmental sustainability.
And they made us rethink the notions of developed and underdeveloped countries.
Yes.
Because there was a very good evaluation that a young group of researchers in Germany examining how the various countries in the world are doing for these 17 goals. And surprisingly, even many of the so-called rich developed countries do very badly on a few of those indicators. So they become, from the perspective of the 17 goals, underdeveloped countries. So there's a lot to do. And some of them are only three or four factors in the United States, or even the Scandinavian country, and a few of those 17 that are lagging behind. So it gives a new perspective on what we should work on.
I think with apologies, we'll take one more question and then we'll sign books. If you can ask a quick question outside afterwards, so then we'll take one more question.
Hi, my name is Megan. I'm a master's in development practice graduate student at Columbia University. We've spoken tonight about altruism as it's experienced and acted upon on an individual level. I was wondering if you could speak about transforming that individual experience to a shared experience in relation to Professor Sachs's anecdote about the banker scenario. So something that's shared experience in a circumstance such as the upcoming climate negotiations. So feeling that identity and altruism together.
In other words, how to make a societal altruism,
yes,
not only an individual altruism.
So that was one of the main reasons of why I was researching that there were many different countries of challenges. One of them, the main one that thought it was based quite late in my research was the idea of evolution and altruism. It was quite a challenge, and it suddenly became clearer when I read the work of Martin Novak recently on super cooperators and divided corporations have been much more creative for evolution and competition to get more critical and progressive. It was one of the last pieces of the puzzle. And then another one was that I was challenged by. Critical mass of paper who said, now we need more caring for our society. It doesn't have to be 50%. It has been shown a strong idea that really appeals to people when you say that.